So, Mr. Vice President, thank you for being here for this interview. I'd like to start with the European Commission's investment plan. What support document did you request to the member states for the projects on the list, like feasibility studies, technical projects, and what is the deadline for submitting these documents?
Well, actually, what we are about to do is to build a European pipeline for the projects. I mean, it means that all the member states or municipalities who are willing to do some investment, first of all, we are helping the country or the municipality, if help is needed, to structure the projects like railway investment or R&D center investment, so that it's liable and it's viable and reliable and very transparent. And then the project is put to the pipeline, meaning that private investors can see what kind of investments there are and they can decide whether they want to finance it or not. If the project itself needs some public support, it can get some loans from new fund, EFSI, or it can get structural funds, or the structural funds could be used as a partial financier of the project. So basically, we want to help and support member states to structure high quality projects, and then there is a common European pipeline which should attract private money.
So coming back to my question, did the Commission, European Commission, requested some feasibility studies, some technical projects from the
not yet, because we just wanted to collect, or the task force who was producing the list was collecting projects which the member states were presenting there, and now if some member states want to get financing from EFSI or EIB, they must apply to the bank, and then the banks are assessing them.
Okay. Who will exactly take part into the committee of experts which will evaluate this project?
There are competition, so open competition, and we don't know yet who they are, but mostly people from private sector who knows financial market, who knows various industries, who are competent enough to assess very complicated projects, infrastructure projects. And what is important is that because now we are talking about lending, not the free money, it's very important that the investment decisions are not done politically, or they are not politically motivated, but they must, all the projects must get its financing according its merit. It's fair for all, and also because the lending from EFSI is maximum, let's say 30% of all the price of the project, we have to attract private money. And that's why the private sector who's supposed to invest in railways or motor roads, they must know that the project is itself has been analyzed by the professionals, and there is no kind of political gain behind it.
Speaking about this private investment that the projects need to attract in order to become reality, do you think that Romania's banking system at this moment can adapt to the complex tools that you, the European Commission, described in this plan? Because there are quite complex tools that are going to be used, and the European Commission and this fund is going to provide needed help. But do you think that the Romanian sector, banking sector, can adapt?
I don't see any major problem in the Romanian banking sector. I would like to encourage the National Promotional Bank and maybe retail banks also to borrow money from the EFSI for financing small and medium-sized enterprises, because this is one area where the fund is supposed to lend more. Also, equity investments to the companies are possible. And this is very important because the EFSI cannot lend money to the SMEs directly, but it means some body who is transmitting the money, and it's either the local banks or promotional bank. I'm sure that there are lots of SMEs who are lacking of equity or loans, and it's very crucial for them in order to grow.
Coming back to the list, when will the final list of projects going to be announced?
There is no final list because the project pipeline and the investment decisions, they will be there permanently. I mean, the bank is assessing processes, projects all the time, every day, and choosing the best of them, and so it's a continuation process. So the list of the projects which kind of go to the project pipeline doesn't necessarily even need any public support. Mm-hmm. Some of them can be financed purely by private sector, and it's, I mean, the best possible scenario. But some of them may need public loans, and if they are good enough, then they can get it.
Romania has sent to Brussels a long list of about 230 projects to enter this proposed funding scheme. All these projects require 62 billion euros in funding. I know that President Juncker and yourself called for credible and feasible projects, but we saw here in Romania a long list of copy-pasted projects from the structural funding. From this point of view, how credible is this list sent by the Romanian government? Because we haven't seen any new creative project that we were expecting to.
Yeah, you have to remember that if the government of Romania want to get more loan for the projects, it means that the government must be strong, or the economy must be strong enough to take the loan. So now we are not talking about grants, but we are talking about loans.
Yeah.
So I guess that no one can, can take that much loan for financing everything in one go. So it's up to the government of Romania or the municipality or whoever is the owner of the project to prioritize and say that this is the project what we need the most, and we can use structural funds partially, but also EFSI help is needed, and help means cheaper loans. So whoever is the owner of the project, the organization must prioritize.
Okay, when is going to start the competition for the projects in the private sector? So not for the governmental projects, municipality projects, but for the companies, SMEs and big companies?
Well, I mean, the market is there. It's politicians cannot influence it, if I understood your question right. So it's a private sector does the investment if they think it's profitable. If private sector needs loans from EIB, they can apply whenever. This happens so every day.
So they can apply to...
Yeah, sure. I mean, the original EIB, they can... EIB is lending some 70 billion per year for private and public. So every day is a good day to do investment plans.
How is the European Commission going to communicate this investment plan for the SMEs so that a small business here in Bucharest or back in your country, in Lahti, let's say, to have the same infos about this big scheme proposed by Brussels as a small or medium enterprise in Brussels or in London?
Yeah, well, there are two ways at least. The first way is, this is my roadshow, I want to send clear messages to SMEs, but also we have to brief national promotional banks who are mostly, in most cases, they are responsible for providing loans or equity investment to SMEs. So we are about to inform the national promotional banks of the new opportunities, and we do hope that country or the banks are active in this front, because there's new opportunities now, and it's up to the local authorities how efficiently the new opportunities are used.
Okay, let's move on quickly to the structural funding for the 2014-2020 programming period. Romania does not have operational programs approved on cohesion policy. When do you estimate they will be approved by the Commission?
I don't know, maybe my colleague Corinne can tell more about this, so I don't want to start guessing.
Okay. Romanian Ministry of European Funds said they want to start a call for projects for the new programming period prior approval of these programs. How do you see this solution? Is this risky, or do you see any some benefits in doing this?
Yeah, I wouldn't like to go to Corinne's area, because she knows it much better than I do.
You coordinate also one of the most sensitive areas in the European Commission, the jobs. I saw the position of Mr. Juncker, but I would also would like to ask you, how do you assess the measures taken by announced by Mr. Cameron, the Prime Minister of the United Kingdom, on workers across the EU? Is there a risk that such measures can be adopted by other European governments?
I think the free movement of people is one of our core values, and we have to make very sure that this will continue also. At the same time, we have to accept the truth that in order to keep integration fair in the people's mind, there must be opportunities for member states to limit the use of social benefits in the case that people is not applying the job or is not working in some particular country. So it's a question of fairness, but as I said, the free movement of people is one of the core values of the EU, and I think that it's very widely shared value even today.
One question about the TTIP, it's a big fuzz around it. I know it's one of the priorities of your commission. What could such a big deal bring for a small economy like Romania's one?
TTIP is very important in terms of job creation and economic growth, because if we had a trade agreement, an investment agreement together with the United States, it would mean that we would have a single market with Americans. So according all the surveys we have done, especially the small and medium-sized enterprises are sending the same message, that it would be easier to operate in the America, it would be easier for us to grow, and it would be easier to create more jobs if we didn't need to struggle with all the trade barriers there are at the moment. So especially for the small and medium-sized enterprises, the trade agreement with Americans is very, very crucial. So it will benefit Europe as a whole. I'm sure that there will be lots of companies in Romania who also benefit from this. And at the end of the day, it's the citizen who get a job who benefits the most.
Thank you. And my last question is a very short one. Most of the independent media outlets, in especially in Eastern Europe, but in the whole EU, struggle in the last years because of the economic crisis, because of the numbers, the circulation numbers are going down, but also because of the unfair competition that we are seeing from the media groups controlled by media moguls. We are calling them like these powerful men with connections into politics and economy. Is this European Commission taking into account tools to support independent journalism?
Well, actually, I don't know what kind of concrete plans there are in the Commission. I have not, or we haven't had any discussions on the college on this issue, but I know exactly what you mean. because of there are changes in the market, in the media market, because people are using internet more and more, and the business logic, the traditional business logic doesn't function as it used to do. So we have to make sure that media is diversified. There are several voices in the media, because it's the precondition of free press, which is the precondition of rule of law, which again, it's the fundamental value of our societies. So we have to make sure that this continues.